I've spent the last 5 videos of this academy teaching you everything there is to know about wire size, wire insulation, wire ampacity, common mistakes, and more. And now it's time to tie all of that information together and teach you step by step how to choose wire sizes. And that's exactly what we're going to cover here in lesson number 6 of this wire basics playlist. My name is Nate, and welcome to the Explorist Life Mobile, Marine, and Off-Grid Electrical Academy. Now, before we get started, I put some important information about this academy, some additional resources, and some prerequisite information related to this video down in the pinned comment below, so be sure to scroll down and check it out. For this video, I'm breaking down my process for choosing wire sizes into 3 categories. How to size wires for components, how to size wires for small DC loads like lights, fans, etc., and how to size wires for 120 volt outlets. How to size wires for components. When I'm sizing wires for components like inverters, charge controllers, or other similar devices, here is the mental flowchart that I use to guide my decision-making process, as these are usually larger amperage devices, and I'm just going to walk you through it. Does the manufacturer make a specific wire size recommendation? This one's pretty self-explanatory. If you look in the user manual of the device, does the manufacturer recommend a specific wire size? For example, the Victron MultiPlus 2000 12-volt inverter charger user manual recommends 70 millimeters squared wire for circuits shorter than 5 meters. Once I have a manufacturer's recommendation, I'm always going to plug that into the Explorist Life wire size calculator just to double check. With a bit of rounding, 2000 watts divided by 12 volts equals 166 amps, operating at 12 volts. With a circuit length of 15 feet, default of 3% voltage drop, and this is recommending 1-gauge wire, which is smaller than the manufacturer's recommendation. This tells me that the manufacturer has likely sized up their wire for various reasons, including decreasing voltage drop and DC ripple, but ultimately, if the wire size recommended by the manufacturer is larger than what is calculated, I'm just going to use the manufacturer's recommendation. What if the calculated wire size is larger than the manufacturer's recommendation? If our wire size calculator recommends a larger size than the manufacturer, this is a huge red flag for me. Historically, this points to a component that is of low quality and/or a poorly translated manual, resulting in errors. If this is the case, proceed with extreme caution, reach out to the manufacturer for clarification, or reach out to a trained professional for guidance and be prepared to ultimately not use that component. What if the user manual of the device does not make a specific wire size recommendation? If the user manual does not make a recommendation, or if the user manual makes a recommendation that I suspect to be incorrect, my path forward is the same. I'm going to figure out if a wire terminal is a stud terminal that accepts a wire lug, or if it's a screw terminal that accepts just a stripped end of wire. Stud terminals are usually a lot more flexible here because a screw terminal has a finite size of wire that will fit inside. No manufacturer's recommendation plus a stud terminal. Now if it's a stud terminal, I'm going to do 2 things. First, I'm going to use the Explorist Life wire size calculator for my baseline. For this example, I looked up a fairly random 2000 watt inverter on Amazon and I could not find a recommended wire size, and I actually couldn't even find a user manual posted online. So I'm just going to take what I know and put it into the calculator. 2000 watts divided by 12 volts gives us 166 amps. Operating at 12 volts, a circuit length of 10 feet, which is 5 feet of positive and 5 feet of negative, with 3% voltage drop on the default. And this gives me 2-gauge. Now from there, to double check my work, I would cross compare this result to a different component of high quality to see if the wire size checks out. For this, I'll refer back to the Victron MultiPlus 2K user manual from earlier, which recommends 2-aught wire. From there, I'm just going to use the larger of those 2 sizes between the calculated 2-gauge and the comparative component of 2-aught. So for this component, I'm going to use 2-aught wire. What if there's no recommendation plus a screw terminal? If it's a component with a screw terminal, like the Victron Smart Solar MPPT 150-100, for example, the user manual does not make a specific wire size recommendation, so we're going to use the Explorist Life wire size calculator for our baseline. This is a 100 amp charge controller operating at 12 volts with a circuit length of 10 feet, which is 5 feet of positive and 5 feet of negative. Default of 3% voltage drop here gives me a result of 4 gauge wire. Next, I'm going to cross-reference this wire size with a high-quality component of similar amperage. And for this example, I pulled up the user manual for the Outback Power FlexMax 100 amp charge controller, which is giving a minimum recommended wire size of 4 gauge. Now, this validation gives me the chance to move forward with at least 4 gauge wire. Next, I need to find out if 4 gauge will actually fit into the screw terminal of the Smart Solar MPPT150-100. The product datasheet for the component tells me the maximum wire size that will fit into the terminal, which is 2 gauge. Since 2 gauge is larger than 4 gauge, I'm going to bump up from the recommended 4 gauge to the max terminal size of 2 gauge for the sake of further reducing voltage drop and ensuring that it's going to work across all applications. But what if the recommended wire size doesn't fit into the wire terminal? Now, this is a huge red flag for me, and I'm going to look at this with a more critical eye and potentially raise my voltage drop threshold, but I'd also be quite prepared to abandon my idea of using this product altogether. If the wire terminal size is inadequate to handle the power the component uses or supplies, I have to wonder about the quality of the component. Now, I couldn't find a specific example of a component where this were the case, but I have stumbled across that in the past when I was offering custom wiring diagram services, and somebody would provide a bunch of no-name parts from who knows where across the internet, but those types of component brands tend to not last very long, and the one that I had in mind looks like it has gone out of business. How to size wire for small DC loads like lights, fans, fridges, etc. It's rare that manufacturers of small devices like lights, fans, fridges, and stuff like that make recommendations on wire size, and wire size choice for these small loads is admittedly not as critical as larger devices like inverters, solar charge controllers, DC to DC chargers, and such. So for this section, we're going to lean heavily into the explorist.life wire size calculator. So two quick examples here. A MaxAir fan operates on high at about 5 amps and 12 volts. Now from our fuse block to the fan is 10 linear feet, which would be 10 feet of positive and 10 feet of negative wire for a total of 20 feet of current carrying wire length. At 3% voltage drop, the calculator recommends 14 gauge wire, so we can use 14 gauge wire for the circuit. If we had 10 LED puck lights on a circuit, each operating at 0.3 amps, this would be a 3 amp circuit at 12 volts. And let's say it was 25 feet from the fuse block to the furthest light in the circuit. This would be 25 feet of positive and 25 feet of negative for 50 total feet of current carrying wire length. At 3% voltage drop, the calculator recommends 12 gauge wire, so we're going to use 12 gauge wire for this circuit. What if you want to consolidate wire sizes? Now you'll notice that we had a result of 12 gauge and 14 gauge wire. If you wanted to consolidate wire sizes and just run 12 gauge, which, as a reminder, is the bigger of the two sizes, for both of those circuits, that's usually fine. The main thing to watch out for is make sure that whatever wire size you use will fit into the terminal for whatever device you're using or whatever fuse block that you're attaching to. This is typically not an issue until you get to wire sizes larger than 10 gauge. Can I use smaller wire? The short answer, no. The long answer, yes, but this is a more advanced technique and requires a crash course in voltage drop. Voltage drop is caused by resistance in a wire. Long wire lengths and high amperages cause voltage drop. The resistance of a long wire length or a high amperage load can cause the voltage to drop a bit over the course of the full circuit, delivering lower voltage to the device. So for our puck light example from earlier, if our battery bank was actually putting out 13.6 volts, and we knew that our puck lights could actually operate in a range of voltages from 10 volts to 15 volts, we could actually tell our calculator to allow for 10% voltage drop. And 13.6 volts in the battery bank times 10% equals 12.24 volts, which is well within our allowable voltage range for the device, which allows us to downsize our wire a bit to 16 gauge. Now, since 16 gauge wire with 105 degree insulation is rated to 25 amps before any derating factors, we are well within our limits here. How do I size wire for 120 volt loads? 120 volt loads may be standard household outlets, shore power inlets, or hardwired air conditioners, and these are actually pretty easy to size. If it's a 50 amp load, use 6 gauge wire. If it's a 30 amp load, use 10 gauge wire. If it's a 20 amp load or multiple 15 amp outlets, and yes, a duplex outlet counts as multiple 15 amp outlets, use 12 gauge wire. But what about derating factors? Now, we spent all of lesson 3.4 of this academy on ampacity derating factors, but honestly, in mobile, marine, and smaller off-grid electrical systems, we typically don't run into those limits because of the small size of systems, limited number of circuits, and shorter lengths of wire. But that is still worth giving a quick glance over to make sure that you're still within safe limits, and all of that was covered in a dedicated video. Now, I hope this helps provide some insight into how I personally size wire for systems I design here at Explorist Life. Now, it is worth mentioning that the DIY system kits and diagrams that we sell in our store over at shop.explorist.life have all the proper wire sizes and types included or figured out for you. If the thought of messing up wire sizes or types scares you away from your next electrical project, we now offer installation services, and I'll put a link to our store and our installation services below. Now, we're going to be referring to wire sizes and types throughout the rest of this academy, so be sure to bookmark this video for future reference and come back to it if you need a refresher. Now that you know everything there is to know about wire sizes and types, it's time to move on to the next chapter of this academy, where we will actually start putting hands on tools, and I'm going to teach you everything that you need to know about cutting, crimping, stripping, and heat shrinking ferrules, wire lugs, PV connectors, and much more onto wires, and the proper tools to do it with. So click up here to watch, and I'll see you over there.